our three stories today are different than they have been. Let's start with this. What is that a picture of? Today's a more contemplative edition. So that's a picture of Stephanie McMahon and Shane McMahon. And what it reminded me of is how different the wrestling world has changed and what our perception of what the possibilities are. We talk a lot, and I talk a lot on Full Disclosure, about how the wrestling world is changing and in many ways for the better. I think the boys have more control. I think this idea that the WWE is the end all be all has left for the most part, and people feel empowered to come up with their own stuff. If you look at the Georgia Wrestling History Awards, most of that stuff is a testament to the boys' own efforts, not being booked into positions and booked into gimmicks, but coming up with their own stuff and fans and promotions benefiting from that. I think that's all great. But the Stephanie McMahon, Shane McMahon picture reminds me of a time when people just assumed they were going to take over the company, and then Triple H was going to take over the company. And now it looks like none of them are going to take over the company. And in fact, if you look at scenarios where the WWE is sold and or Nick Khan is in charge of absolutely everything, it's hard to imagine that there'll even be a place for the McMahon children or for Triple H. Again, it's the kind of story or the kind of thought-provoking thing I just want to throw out there. Can you believe? Because boy, it wasn't that long ago where people were like, inevitably Triple, look at the great stuff happening at NXT and the Performance Center. Triple H is going to take over once Vince McMahon goes away, or for whatever reason, Triple H will take over and things will get better. And it's this family business, and it's always going to be a family business. And any discussions about selling the WWE means you got to make sure that Stephanie and Shane and these people are taken care of and put in a prominent position. None of that feels real anymore. Oh, once Triple H takes over, he'll get rid of Kevin Dunn and we can start doing different stuff. None of that feels like it's going to happen anymore. I just find it very interesting and noteworthy. Story number two. I finished Butts in Seats. It's a comic book. It's 12 different artists, 10 chapters. How is it? It's very good. But it's also very expensive, right? 25 bucks normally. Did I enjoy it? I did. It definitely left me wanting more detail in the stories. I felt like the comic book aspect of it only was really taken advantage of on three specific occasions. Otherwise, it feels like, why did this have to be a comic book? Except that it gets through stories in a much more efficient fashion because it is a comic book. But it felt like it only took advantage of the comic book format on two or three different occasions. Do I enjoy it? Do I'm glad I have it? Of course, I'm glad I have it. Did I enjoy it thoroughly for what is here? I absolutely enjoyed it, and it just made me want to hear more and learn more and know more. And unfortunately, things weren't in great detail because how could they be? I did love the story of how Tony Schiavone got introduced to pro wrestling in general and how he worked his way up. I love the stuff where they wove in his real life and the considerations that he had to make, having a wife and children and the decisions he had to make accordingly and how cautious the wrestling business made him. And then of course the stories at the end where he kind of he by his own description goes, okay, I know this is what you want. So here's a story about Barry Windham, here's a story about Bobby Heenan, here's a story about Sting and Flair and Wahoo McDaniel and stuff. And that part's really great, but this thing, I guess the long and short of it is it just made me want more. Which is a good thing, and also, if I'm being honest, a vaguely unsatisfying thing. But I do feel like I know Tony Schiavone better. And so, in that sense, it is incredibly successful. And Tony Schiavone just seems like the kind of dude you want to know. Really great guy, really honest about stuff. On the honesty scale, this is amongst the tops of any wrestling thing I've read. As far as making you want more, it's the absolute top. But as far as feeling like a truly fulfilling experience, inevitably it couldn't do that just because of the format. But I do feel very unsatisfied, if I'm being honest. But it's lovely. And it will have a prominent spot where people will can and should read it whenever they come and see me. Finally, cringe wrestling takes. Find them on Twitter. It's not a secret that Twitter is poison. It's not a secret that Twitter, when it comes to pro wrestling, is some of the most horrible stuff. It's hard to really like any fan base once you see them in action on Twitter. But if, like me, there's a kind of a perverse pleasure in the worst of it, cringe wrestling takes on Twitter is well worth joining and reading. And I said this in my commentary. We have to develop this mentality of two things can be true and more nuanced takes. And cringe wrestling takes really shows you why more nuance is in order. And the person who does the cringe wrestling takes does a great job. They take submissions and then they pick the cringiest of the cringe and put them up there. Because I always have a video clip, I want to leave you with one. This one was a response of the at the end of the Dallas Cowboys football game. And while it's not directly wrestling related, this thing is so awesomely over the top crazy. It did definitely remind me of wrestling fans. In any case, that's one, two, three stories about pro wrestling. Thank you for joining me for the Platinum Pinfall. Hey, welcome to the Platinum Pinfall. Of course, I usually do these for my Patreon people right away and then release them a couple of days later to the general public. In fact, today is the first time we're going to do the week's worth compilation for people at large and YouTube and that kind of thing. And that's great. If I seem a little less animated than usual, it's because JL Braden, who wrestled for Platinum Championship Wrestling as Master J, died. And he died apparently a few months ago. And it's just sort of come out. And I'm gonna probably open this thing and close it talking about him, and then I'll have two other stories. And I may not I just might not make this Patreon first. I feel like JL Braden deserves to be talked about. In any case, he a couple of things that really struck me. One of them was this. It was a picture that Shane Marks put up. Pop. Yeah. And Shane Marks in a promo said the one of the coolest things I've ever heard said about another wrestler from a non-manager, no less, where we had a thing where Master J was his bodyguard. And he did a number of other things at PCW, but I'll always remember him as a guy who was a huge part of the Empire during the initial sort of invasion stage, and then he was there for some huge moments. And then so he was like the de facto bodyguard for Miss Rachel and Shane Marks for quite some time. And Shane Marks said, "This man is a ninth degree in everything." And it was one of the greatest lines ever. And I'm glad that Shane Marks recalled that line. And the picture is so wonderful to me. And it's the one I used for the rest in peace picture that's going to be at the end of this video. But this whole picture, you see Miss Rachel, you see Shane Marks, you see him. And Shane Marks put up this picture with ninth degree and everything, but a couple other notable things is somebody who's like taking pictures of them, A really animated crowd, and then Larry Goodman there is looking lovingly at the little clip, the little click of Shane Marks Rachel and Master Jay. And I think there's something so perfect about it and so wonderful. So I wanted to put that picture, sorry. And now I want to put up this. What is this? This is from his page. And he trained at WWA4, and he probably wrestled for a number of promotions, but the only one he ever claimed, and he was so proud to be there, was Platinum Championship Wrestling. It's the only one that he claims, right? And he was such an easygoing dude to get along with, and he was really just happy to be part of the show. And everybody else would sort of talk to me about wanting to do more, like, normal, natural stuff, but he was just like, dude, you're always coming up with stuff for me to do, and I'm fucking loving it. And that makes me so happy. And our clip, since I always have a video clip, is gonna be, I want to tell the story now just in case I forget to tell it later on. So we had our big 11/11/11 show, November 11th, 2011, where it was supposed to be we're a 10-on-10 elimination match, which was famous for Shane Marks turning heel, bloodying Jay Fury, bloodying me, the introduction of Jeff G. Bailey as the secret benefactor and leader of the Empire, and it was a big, huge deal. It was the last time I wrestled as the Lethal Litigator. But what gets lost in the shuffle, when you have a 10 versus 10 elimination match with one ring, you'll see how packed the ring is in that clip. Just guys lining up on the apron, like basically surrounding the whole apron. It's crazy. But the first guys who really got it going in that match were De La Vega, who was not really seen as a big time player yet. Right, he was part of the Surrealists. They did comedy stuff earlier in that show. They did a bit where De La Vega dressed as Darth Vader and then gets shot by Maya, who uses like a Nerf gun to like shoot him as a like a blaster and then like drags him off. So he had never been like a main event player, and he was definitely seen as someone who's going to be fodder in this 10-on-10 match for all the marbles. And Master Jay and Vega were going to start this match. So there's a big brawl to start, but then everything gets settled and then they go into the match. And the clip that I chose, I try to keep the video clips short, really highlights how good that guy was and how he rose to the moment. Because everybody else had their, little bit of ego, right? I want to make sure I get my moment, even though there's all this crazy stuff. And then there was stuff that was like booked to happen that were like big, pivotal moments in the match, and but he was just like, I just want this thing to look good, and he wanted to put Vega over hard. He's like, I want it's the first pinfall, I want the crowd to go crazy. And so when you look at the execution, it is the best missed clothesline I've ever seen. I know you're saying, Steve, what the fuck, dude? You will see in the clip at the end. Hell, if you want to go back and watch that first, go ahead. It is the best missed clothesline that he throws in Vega. Like, it really looked like he was trying to take his head off, but he missed. And then the way he takes Vega's cross body coming off the ropes was so freaking good. Master J, Jeffrey, JL Braden, thank you. And I'm glad PCW meant a lot to you, but you were an integral part and a huge part of really the biggest thing we ever did up to that point. And you were the opposite of a pain in the ass to deal with. You were great. The feud that you had with East Coast Lightning Tacoma, where you guys had Kumite match, we took down the ropes for you guys. I mean, thank you. PCW was guys that would just sort of come in from all different places. And he's somebody who came in and, Jeff G. Bailey tells it to me all the time. The point of wrestling is to get in and get over. And he did. And so thank you. And rest in peace and condolences to his family and friends. He's a really nice person, a really good guy, and I and so many people who got to work with him and watch him are going to think of him fondly. So that's one thing. We'll get to the other two parts of the Platinum Pinfall, and they're awfully silly. Hey, WWE and your love of Nazis. Boom, you've probably seen something about the story about Gunther Stark, which is a name that the WWE is trying to trademark to give to Walter, because goodness knows Walter is not over enough that we have to give him this dumb name. So they give him this name, Gunther Stark, presumably without Google searching at first, because if you do a Google search for the name Gunther Stark, what you see is this guy, Nazi submarine captain of note, enough to have his own entry and stuff. It's mind-blowing, but more mind-blowing since that story came out yesterday, but they're doubling down and they're gonna do it. Oh, yeah. So I could excuse, okay, we didn't do a simple Google search. I can see how that could slip through the cracks. The WWE has fired so many people. They've never done well with that stuff. But at this point, to continue to go through with it, one, to give the guy a Nazi name is terrible on so many levels. Two, what are you changing this guy's name for that you've let him use in both NXT and NXT UK? And to people that say, like, well, you want to own the trademark and you want to have the rights in case you ever. Are you telling me if Gunther Stark Walter left, that he wouldn't just go back to the name Walter and it would be like as over or more so than Gunther Stark? And by the way, for the people that claim, oh, the WWE, it's much better that they construct these names. I don't know. Okay, I'm gonna name three people who either kept their gimmick name that they used in the indies or used their real name. And you decide for yourself whether that worked better. You ready for the names? CM Punk, John Cena, and Brock Lesnar. But by all means, Gunther Stark. And then our last story before we go into Master Jay's clip and his bit of magic that he created with De La Vega, which really set the spark for arguably the biggest match in Platinum Championship Wrestling history, is Jericho also is going out with a trademark. He wants, put him up, GFY, go fuck yourself, because he basically said something along those lines to Eddie Kingston. And Jericho's always been that guy, man. He's going to find a way to make money. Do I personally like it? I don't, which means it'll probably make a crap ton of money. But it also shows Jericho's always been that guy. I say something, I can maybe put it on a shirt, I can maybe parlay it into more money, and he's always really careful about doing that. So let me ask this, wrestling people. Maybe the only person that you're fucking is yourself by not doing much the same. This has been the Platinum Pinfall. One, two, three. Jail Braden, Jeffrey, Master J to me. Shane Mark said it best. You were ninth degree in everything, brother. Enjoy this clip. Tell me I'm wrong about the best missed clothesline in wrestling history and that great take on the crossbody. Love you guys. Love him too.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
Welcome to the Platinum Pinfall. I'm on location. I'm at this park. I think it's called Colonial Park.
there's a gap between dropping both of my kids off, and there's a little bit of bubbled it up. Anyway, it's Platinum Pinfall. I'm going to record a couple here this morning and make best use of my time. So I'm going to have two different color schemes. Today is purple. Are you excited? One, two, three quick stories about wrestling. Hopefully I can add the tech elements later. Otherwise, this part's going to look crazy. What is this? Richard Borger, who's the guy who ran Face to Face, one of the worst names of any wrestling group. But I did come up with that schnazzy 90s sitcom style theme for Face to Face. And that stuff will get into your head. So Richard Borger had this to say over here. So he owned Face to Face, which is a wrestling school where he had Simon Sermon training sometimes. And then when Simon Sermon wasn't there, Richard Borger would open up a book about wrestling and read it to the wrestlers and make them do drills based on what he read in the book. Yeah, so, but then he sold it, but then apparently he got it back, but now he sold it again. So he says, so just to let everyone know, as there have been people messaging me regarding my status with Face to Face Wrestling, I am no longer affiliated in any way with the school or its shows. God, Richard Borger is such a weird dude. It is under new ownership. I will, however, be moving forward and launching an independent promotion. That will be running in three locations. In Georgia soon. I hope to be running a show in Morrow at a new location soon. God, he keeps saying soon. So that fans of my shows can still come and be entertained. So that's weird enough. But here's the thing. Three locations. He's given up control to somebody else somewhat. How can he suddenly do all this? Because he's teamed up with Ron Gossett, the guy who keeps starting shows, and they're going to be big, and they're going to be the new WCW, or they're going to be this, and they're going to be that, and then the funding falls through, and then a bunch of bullshit happens, and then he's begging people for money, like Tommy Pinarelli, can you just do this, and na 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 na. So that Ron Gossett. My hopes are not high, though it looks like that I am. Supposedly, though, Ronnie Gossett has been running shows in South Carolina without incident. And that's gone on long enough. And he's like, fuck this. Me and Richard Borger are going to team up and have a clusterfuck baby together. At least that's my prediction. Oh, Steve, why can't you be more positive? Because I'm too aware of the world and how it works. All right. Next story. According to Scotty Tuhati, who was a performance center coach, let's put up a little picture of him. Oh, looks good. Looks good. Vince McMahon wants the performance center trainers to look younger. This is not a kayfabe news story. This is a real story. He says, as soon as it started to change, Hunter went away and the other guys started to come in. It was, okay, back to business casual now. The next week, this is awesome. The next week it was, hey, Vince McMahon wants the coaches looking younger. We need you guys to start dyeing your beards and cutting your hair. The coaches. I literally lost sleep over that. A couple went and did it right away. I've had every kind of facial hair. Dyed, not dyed, chin strap, goatee, beard, everything. Spiked hair, bald head. It's not about that. It's just, they're making us jump through hoops like monkeys just to see if we'll do it. If you do that, what's next? That was just the beginning. Because Scotty Tuhati said, peace out, even though you know he loved that job. And you could see that in his like goodbye post to the WWE Performance Center. He loved that job. And I know we've all had jobs where they start imposing weird bullshit. Usually it's predicated by a meeting that you go to, and then the boss says weird shit. And dude, that stuff is freaking ridiculous. And it is a crying, crying shame. So, our third story. Scotty 2, how do you rule? Our third story is John Moxley came back last night. And our clip is going to be how he addressed a fan. Imagine being a fan who goes to this Dynamite. John Moxley's making his return. Everybody's super pumped up. And then you're going to yell, get out of the ring, you drunken bum, or whatever the hell. Again and again and again, trying to screw him up. And so the clip we're going to see at the end is John Moxley's response, and it's fucking awesome. I'm a big fan of the Mox. His book is amazing. But I wanted to also talk about this before we have that video clip. Look how much younger John Moxley looks. He looks great. I will say before he went into rehab, though, you know, body-wise, and he was all muscled up like your boy, by the way. Look at this. Working out, paying off, looking good. Bro, let's do the muscles, bro. Like, has muscles. But Moxley looks 10 years younger now, man. He looks great. And it's great to have him back. Wrestling needs him. And wrestling also needs to deal with fans like he deals with. And I'm going to show you that in a second. But this has been the 1, 2, 3 Platinum Pinfall. John Moxley! I do love Justin Roberts' call of that.
Hey, go fuck yourself. Get that guy out of here. Piece of shit.
Well, he ain't changed much.
Welcome, darling, to the Platinum Pinfall. 1, 2, 3 quick stories about pro wrestling. Today, it's got more of a local flair in the Georgia area, which is, of course, really, really cool. The first one is, in a sense, it's a bit of a disappointing story, but I have a feeling that it is just the first chapter in a book of awesome. And here it is. This picture was sent to me a few weeks ago. Who's that? That's Chip Day, and that's Kyle Matthews at an AEW event. Super excited. I couldn't wait to see it. You know, I cover the darks and the dark elevations and all of that stuff. Apparently, they were taking on Wardlow and Sean Spears, but because for angle reasons of what Sean Spears and Wardlow are kind of moving towards and all this other stuff, I guess they're not going to show that match most likely. Leaf confetti parade, but that's cool, and that's all right, because even though I would love to see Kyle and Chip, I have a feeling AEW is going to use them again, or they would be fools not to. By the way, that's a call out to all other groups. I did that for Chip. I certainly would do that for Kyle as well. I'm not a big fan of, you need to book these people, but you got to book these guys, bro. And I just think that picture of them and the good lighting and all that stuff looks so freaking cool. Hopefully I remember to pull that thing off of my phone and put the picture here, or else that's going to look really weird. This background's pretty cool though, huh? Whoosh! Our second story, this one's a bit weird, but it's you know, whenever we catch or we hear about somebody in wrestling, the wrestling business who needs to be called out for stuff, and we need to get predators out and all that other stuff. This is just a reminder that that applies for more than just people in the wrestling business, but the people who live on the periphery, who can be just as sus, if not more so. So there's this guy called Heel Josh. He's a really popular online streamer in regards to wrestling. He streams his reaction to wrestling shows on Twitch and makes TikTok and YouTube videos talking about wrestling like somebody else that we know. He was one of the on-air commentators for the opening match of Zicky Dice's Paradise Show. And I remember that. However, he wasn't there in person. He did it via remote. So here's the story. About a month ago, online, people started speaking out because he's kind of a bully and he blocks people for disagreeing with him and stuff like that. That's one thing that you can say about your boy. People try to hurt my life, and I've never blocked anybody. But they all end up blocking and unfriending me. That's for them. Fuck y'all. But anyway, so this guy, Heel Josh, the badass, blocks people for disagreeing. And then people started saying that he would make them feel stupid because they didn't understand wrestling. I mean, your boy, I don't make any bones about that. I'm for wrestling people. If wrestling fans want to get on board, that's cool. But just know, I let you know from the jump, right? But many more people contact me and have signed up for my Patreon, hint, hint, wink, wink, because they find me very versed in wrestling, and I'm a teacher first, right? Anyway, this led to a mini cancel culture of him amongst the internet wrestling community. It's crazy that the IWC still is around, but his audience was too large for it to matter. But now, an underage girl who is known and loved in the online wrestling community said Josh sent her inappropriate message. The girl who's being, her identity is being protected, shared the screenshots with some people in the community in a Discord chat. And this person who's telling me this saw those screenshots, and she is not lying. The guy's probably going to get arrested for this at some point. And he hasn't been on social media, which is this guy's lifeblood, since the Zicky Dice show. Now, this is no flies on the Zicky Dice show. They hopefully didn't know about any of this, and at least the guy did it remotely and didn't do it in person, thank goodness. But it looks like that guy's about to get destroyed, and rightfully so. The story is about to go mainstream, but you're hearing it here first, because I'm your boy, and because people tell me things, and people show me evidence, and then I get to give it to you.
And because you joined up on the Patreon, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, give us money.
Oh my goodness, my kid hitting that good stuff for me. Appreciate you, kid. Appreciate you. Yeah. So let's get on to our great story, and then we're gonna have a little bit of we're gonna have a clip as well, at some point. So what is this? Terminus poster! Freaking awesome. February 24th, they're coming back. See what I just did there? I was thinking in my mind, because it's got this whole Black Panther theme and it looks really cool. Look. They did great. They sold out their show. They had a successful show. The clip I'm going to show you is just a little bit of wrestling. So you can see how good, just a little piece of how good that Josh Alexander against a Jonathan Gresham match was. But they're coming back with style. They don't have to ram anything down anybody's throat. They didn't ram they're going to be back February 24th. They're going to be back next month. And it's going to be fire. I'm so proud of that show. And it was so great. And Larry absolutely adored it. And this is my kid's crab. That's wanted it part of the shot. I thought it'd be better on my knee.
If we're going with green, we gotta go with green, you know?
That's right, because this crab is green. In any case, congratulations to Terminus. I'm curious to see if the Zicky Dice show, which had a very successful first show, when their follow-up is going to be. But I'm really glad that Terminus is going to hit that scene hard. It looks like it's going to be about once a month. Is the second show going to be as successful as the first one financially? Are they going to sell it out? That's up to the people, isn't it? But I have a feeling it's going to do very, very well once again. And before I show you that clip, just as a reminder that this is the 1, 2, 3 Platinum Pinfall 3 quick stories about wrestling. Wakanda forever! I accidentally deleted this first take, and it upsets me because it was fucking great. But what do? We just got to move on. We just got to try again. And who knows? It might come out better the second time. Let's see. Now, this goes out to my Patreon people first. Patreon's growing.
I want to get that thing above 30 people. We're getting really close. It's wonderful. Just as a reminder, if people are seeing this 2 days from now, you can see these things as soon as they come out when the news is fresh, fresh, exciting. It's so inviting to me. Let's get into our first story. I'm very excited about this one. Let's put up the pictures first. Who is that? That's AC Mack. Fucking Mack. Winning IWTV. They're calling it a world title. I'm inclined to agree. Winning that shit at Action Show, which was a Roman triumph. No doubt about it. Sold out house. Rob Rod's there with the clicker. Now, I've jumped on Rod Rod many times before. You know why? Because I want his reports to be fucking better. And I want him to stop being liked and start getting him respected. And that's going to happen when those reports read better. And it's going to happen when he stops taking people at their word and starts putting the fucking facts down when it's appropriate. And it makes me happy that he's got the clicker and he's making sure that crowd is right. But here's the facts. Action Wrestling, it's a fucking Roman triumph. Sold out, packed out house. IWTV's there. They're hosting this event, showcasing the Southeast, which is so important, right? I'm just going to go off the cuff because I'm doing this for a second time. So let's be honest. Southern wrestling gets shit on compared to the Northeast. It's just a fact. And what is the answer? It's going to take a bunch of things. But Action showcasing and IWTV helping them out the way that they are is a huge step. It's a huge step. An enormous step. Respect is only going to come when you show that you can do, you can play the Northeast game as well as the Northeast can. When you get some guys some looks. And I've been critical of the Action model in the past, in the sense that, you know, when they were tie-ins with the charity, which is incredibly respectable and all of that good stuff, but I said, but that's not a real crowd, because again, when more than half your people are there and they don't really care about the wrestling part, it reflects in the product. No matter what idiots like David Marquez want to say, it's like, it matters. Your audience matters. It does. And they've got that audience. More than one person told me this. They said, Matt Griffin is the promoter of the year. They go, as soon as they go into Tyrone, and it's Tyrone is nowhere near anything. Let me make that clear. For those that don't know Georgia or don't know Tyrone or haven't been to Action Wrestling, it's not fucking near anything. So you got to go out of your way to go see that thing. And well over 200 people really did. They were there for an experience. And as soon as you go into town, there's Action posters everywhere. And what was described to me was Matt Griffin running shit. They're early, stay late. All this IWTV stuff is going on. Everybody's getting their needs met. Matt Griffin is organizing, delegating, as well as taking care of shit himself. That's a fucking man running some shit. It's what I saw with Ace Haven and Pro South. It's what I see increasingly at IWE. It's what I know Matt Hankins does, which is why the fucking boys fucking rewarded that man. And is this going to upset Gary Lamb? Probably, but fuck. I think the promoter of the year should be the person who fucking gives a fuck about what they're doing. Matt Griffin does. And that show last night reflected it. I went out of my way to watch it. I don't watch a lot of stuff on IWTV. I watched a lot of the deathmatch stuff. But I don't really watch, because, by the way, after this, I'm going to record, you know, my 9 different national show frickin' recap video I'm doing for the first time. I don't know what the fuck that's going to be, but we'll find out. So I watch a lot of wrestling. And then I go to shows live. And I work every day, like, etc., right? Whatever. Wah, wah, violin. But I went out of my way to watch that thing. I even posted about it. Like, because it's not just that they had a packed crowd for that building. It's that they were hyped. And there was a crackling energy about it. And they were showcasing the Southeast, and it pulled off successfully. IWTV has to be thrilled, and Action certainly has to be proud. Look at these pictures. Look how proud AC Mack is. I want to talk about AC Mack last. Last time I talked about him first on that first take. I'm gonna talk about him last. I'm going to talk about Matt Griffin and Action and how successful that was and how vital it is and how great the Georgia scene is. You've got two guys there covering the show, and Rob Rod and Duke Ingram. You've got IWTV, who's thrilled. And the commentary last night, by the way, worlds better than the last time I listened to Action. And that pop for AC Mack winning. That's fucking home run shit. It's show of the year until somebody knocks it off the pedestal, if you can. And AC Mack is your wrestler of the year until somebody can knock him off the top, if you can. We're in January. Fucking great. Now let's talk about AC Mack. Do you know how blessed Georgia is to have a guy like AC Mack and Joe Biden? These guys can cut promos. These guys can work. And these guys, they do what they're supposed to do, but they also have their own mind and their own voice. And they're guys who listen, but they don't listen too much. And sometimes the thing they listen to the most aren't these entities talking to them, but they listen to this and they listen to this. And they're fucking smart, and they got hearts. AC Mack is part of a new group that's a prototype. I don't know how far he's going to go in the wrestling business or what the fuck ever. Will this be the peak for him? I don't think so. Might be. Because when you're the new, sometimes people don't recognize. I think that happened a little bit with PCW. We were the fucking new. I broke that ground. Other people have spoken about this before. And now other people are reaping the benefits, and that's wonderful. And AC Mack is that new. But I think he can transition to something bigger as well. Happy for him. Happy for Action. Happy to be a little bit wrong about stuff. Or happy that my mind was changed. Fuck, it's going to be a great year. Georgia got it like that. And Action is going to be a big part of the rest of the country fucking seeing it. I believe that. From the good to the shit, but it's Bully Ray, his take on John Moxley, that John Moxley should have apologized to the crowd. What kind of take is that? It's this kind of take. The shittiest take I've heard in a long time. Fuck Bully Ray. And Bully Ray's had multiple shitty takes, and Conan and Disco have multiple shitty takes, and Jim Cornette increasingly has more and more shit takes. And then fucking locally, Nick and Myron's take that fucking Southern Honor will be the new Ring of Honor is the shit. Look, I get it. As somebody who has now puts out three strong opinions about shit a day, you're going to have misses. I'm not talking about misses. I'm talking about guys that whose brains don't even fucking think in the right way. I love big choices, and with big choices, you're going to have stuff that crashes and burns. But my God, why do we accept and listen to people that have way more misses than hits? Is fucking beyond me and have nothing to teach. Jim Cornette at least has things to teach. So I don't put him in quite in the same category as the other people, but fuck me. Bully Ray and his shit takes and shit attitude about stuff and incredibly bad behavior over the last few years and just, it's a fucking blight. Can we stop? Can we start fucking really getting it? Because there are people out there who are fucking working and doing shit. And the people who are really producing something, instead of just... When ESPN has gone to this format of just guys giving shit takes, and it is to the detriment of that channel. Now, I get that things have modified. Why do I need to watch SportsCenter when my fucking phone can tell me everything instantaneously? I get that. The format has changed, and the business model has changed. But what they replaced it with is shit takes. Fucking these hot shit takes. Taking a hot shit on people's fucking minds. And Bully Ray's take was shit. And there's a bunch of other people giving you shit takes. And we gotta stop fucking. We gotta know. We gotta recognize a shit take when we hear it. We do. And we have to start recognizing teachers. And people passing on information. Fuck Bully Ray. And yes, when I hear a shit hot take, I'm gonna fucking tell you about it. And you're gonna see that hippo. Because that shit makes me laugh every time. Because I'm an aristocrat. Third story, fun. Fun in wrestling. That action show, fun. Right? A lot of aspects of AEW, fun. A lot of deathmatch stuff right now, fun. Excitement. I'm going to tell you about fun, though. And anybody who's been around me when I directed fucking theater, improv comedy shows, pro wrestling, any kind of project. And it's something I teach my children, and it's something that people have heard me say a bunch of times. Maybe you've heard it a bunch of times. You're about to hear it again. And that is fun when it is used as an excuse for something not being good. Fun show. I had fun. Fun. That's bullshit. That's replacing the ability to improve with a dismissive thing of, well, fun is the goal. You know what fun is? Fun is when you achieve greatness. I'll tell you, I'd rather have, because I just watched the Kevin Garnett documentary, right? When he was going to Jamaica after not making the playoffs, he probably had fun. But wasn't he much happier yelling, anything is possible? Wasn't that real fun? Action had real fun last night. AEW's having real fun. And it's weird. There's symptomatic stuff. Forced fun is some bullshit. Forced fun is not funny. The forced fun that you often see in bad comedy vignettes in wrestling. I'm not against comedy in wrestling. I'm against, is it genuine fun? Is it genuinely appealing to an audience? Is there an interaction going back and forth, right? That's real fun. But fun is symptomatic. It can be symptomatic of greatness, but it can also be the thing that draws greatness out or the strongest indication that greatness is taking place. And Sting and Darby Allin, let's just get to the point. Sting and Darby Allin, that booking and that pairing has worked out beyond what most people conceived of. When people talk about somebody getting the rub and old guy working with a younger guy and to the benefit of both of them, that they are, the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. And I think it's beyond anybody's wildest imagination, except for maybe those two guys and Tony Khan. So they deserve credit for that. And the symptom of, you know that it's great and you know that it's going well, is shit like this. So this is, we're going to end with a clip of Sting and Darby in their car. So they're traveling together. Best buddy cop movie ever. So they're traveling together. And they're, because AEW hardcore fans stay late, they're stuck in traffic behind them trying to get out of the venue. And they see the car ahead of them has an AEW license plate. So Sting and Darby decide to have this fun and record it. Tell me that isn't genuine joy. Tell me that isn't fun. Tell me, when is the last time you've heard about shit in WWE happening that was like that? I'm not saying the WWE can never get there again. I'm just saying they're so far away from there now. And it tells me that it's places like AEW, Action Wrestling, etc., that are going to push wrestling in a different direction. And people are going to start looking to them as the guides, as the North Star to move towards. Instead of just inevitably saying, well, it's the WWE or bust. Go where the magic is. Go where the joy is. Go where pro wrestling is. Is 2022 is going to be the real start of that shit. Enjoy Sting, enjoy Darby enjoying themselves, and I'll talk to you later. This has been 1, 2, 3, the Platinum Pinfall.
Hurry up.
All right, we're going to surprise, me and Stinger and surprise this guy.
And so, our three stories today, put that up first. I just picture of Leo Rush. He's one of the guys whose contract is ending, along with Joey Janela with AEW, Peter Avalon, Brian Cage, and possibly others. And it looks like a lot of these guys, it's going to run out, and they're not going to get renewed, and they're gone. Leo Rush most certainly is gone and is already putting himself out there. What is my take on this, right? AEW, by going the we're just going to let contracts run out route, definitely doesn't get nearly the backlash that WWE does. Not that they would have anyway, honestly. AEW gets, they're still in a honeymoon phase where they get a little bit of a pass on things. What do I think about these losses? Please comment or write me and tell me your thoughts. My thing is, boy, AEW has needed to make cuts for a long time, and I don't really think they're losing a whole lot. I think they invested a lot into Leo Rush to not get a payoff off of it, but that was as much his doing as anything else. And clearly, you know, I've always said talent trumps issues. But it doesn't always, right? I'm just saying in general, like, you know, Leo Rush is an incredibly talented guy who just seems like he's a pain in the ass to deal with in a lot of ways. And him leaving at this point, I don't think it really hurts them. It seems like they've already moved on. Same with Brian Cage. I just don't think they were getting the return out of him. Now, of course, that's on both ends. But overall, I don't really see anybody that's not going to be there any longer as a humongous loss. Do you disagree? Now, things are going to get more and more urgent as the year continues and more contracts begin to run out. And then we're going to see what's up. But for now, this is definitely a calm before a possible storm. Next story. So I played one particular mobile game. To get different things done in the game, you can either like pay game currency, which I don't like to do. I like to stockpile that stuff, and I certainly don't spend money on mobile games to get that currency. Or you can watch ads. And here's two screenshots from one of the ads that popped up. And then GCW show that's happening tonight at the Hammerstein Ballroom that's already sold out. But they're really pushing this thing. And seeing ads for it pop up on this mobile game was like mind-blowing. Mind-blowing that they're thinking out of the box of how can we reach more people to buy this thing who may be interested. I'll be curious to see what kind of numbers they draw on Fight TV now. But I think it's very interesting. I think it's noteworthy. I think that's very noteworthy that GCW now sees their potential audience as a national or international one. That they've got the sellout at Hammerstein. It had that a long time ago. And now it's, how many people can we get to buy this bitch? I'll be curious to see if it works. I will say I've heard a ton about this show from multiple different sources, and that usually portends good things, right? Advertising, people have to hear about things three different ways before they consider it. And then our final thing is this TikTok that I saw that somebody sent to me. Made me laugh, right? When you got a trap guy and Jeff Hardy sort of mixed together, but it made me think, here's my challenge to wrestling people. How can you integrate something about you and what you do in with another type of pop culture to really accentuate both? Something to think about. This is the shortest edition of 1, 2, 3, the Platinum Pinfall we have, but I got to get going, and I think you'll find that this little TikTok video at the end of this thing is definitely worth it. I certainly didn't do it. The credits are on there. But it's a lot of fun. So some stuff to think about. GCW with alternate kind of advertising to reach a younger and different kind of demographic. And how can you cross your stuff over in general? And what do you think about this A? I want to interact with you. What do you think about these AEW guys that are not going to be re-signed? Is it going to affect AEW in a negative way, or does it say something negative about AEW? Or is it going to be a positive? Is it going to be addition by subtraction? Let me know. Now watch this video. So if it ain't about this money, make it quick. First, I see that this is show number 14 that I'm doing, which means it's going to come out in the big release when I release a week at a time, which is awesome because I think it's a really good one. Let's just jump right into this bad boy. So our first story has to do with the Royal Rumble. It is a cliche at this point, though it is a very apt cliche. I think most people would say that the Royal Rumble is their favorite WWE pay-per-view of the year and has been for a very long time, and there's a lot of reasons for that, but not the least of which, it's the show that has surprises. It's the show that lets you know how WrestleMania is going to look. It's the show that just has a built-in level of excitement with the match itself, the countdown, what is so-and-so going to do this year? How's Kofi going to stop from touching the floor? It's just all of these great stories, which I hope that they can maintain this. But again, as I continue to report on different signs that the WWE is not as big as they once were and is not the end-all be-all that they once were, I think there's two stories related to the Royal Rumble that are really interesting. The first is the NXT people who are going to be involved in the Royal Rumble. So we know that both Bron Breakker and Gunther, the former Walter, are scheduled to be at the event, and it's going to be in St. Louis, Missouri this time. So I think that that's really cool. Are they going to be in the match itself? What does that mean? Or are they going to make an appearance otherwise? It feels like both of them are quickly outgrowing whatever it is that NXT 2.0 is now. So that is an interesting story. But the other one is that the inspiration, the once iconics at the WWE, turned down a Royal Rumble invite. Very telling. You would think that the part of them would be like, dude, we want to, you know, this is our way to get back in and blah, 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 blah. And instead, they're just like, oh, screw that. We're not doing that stuff after they got rid of us the way they got rid of us. And I say good for them, but really, really, really telling nonetheless, don't you think? Speaking of AEW and WWE and, well, not Impact so much, there's two things about the ratings that I think are of note. So I'm going to put them up here. NXT, the last one, ranked number 50 on the cable top 150 this week with a 0.11 rating in the key demographic. This is down from what they were the previous week. They ranked number 70 in viewership on cable this week. That's down. Tuesday's NXT audience was the third lowest since the NXT 2.0 rebranding. The episode was tied with three other episodes for the lowest key demo rating in the USA Network. There was an episode that aired on Sci-Fi that drew a slightly lower key demo rating. That is misery, misery, misery. The other one is talking about Dynamite. Now, this isn't me comparing Dynamite to NXT, though there's a time where you could. This is me noting that Dynamite, they got over 1 million viewers. Great. But their demo number of 0.38. And again, this was following a very bad Dynamite, in my opinion. Right? Those segments, Moxley, Mixed Tag, Cody Rhodes, all got a 0.48, more than quadrupling what NXT got as far as the key demo went. But here's the important stuff. Dynamite was number one in cable. It beat out an NBA game, whereas Raw continues to get shellacked by the NFL. Now, that's going to relinquish now that there's no more NFL, and then we're going to really find out what Raw be doing. But, boy, if there was any doubt who won that Wednesday night war, it's over now, right? NXT has made decisions. And the scuttlebutt goes that at this point, they're worried that NXT will get canceled off of USA Network. They're old. The people who watch that show are old. The show doesn't feel must-see. They continue to beg for people to go. Just to be able to go to the Performance Center alone, you think would be enough of a draw to fill up the 400 seats that they have in that place when they're giving it out for free. And they're shuttling you from Full Sail to there if you want to do it. There's hot and there's not. And I'll be curious to see what comes of NXT. But I know what's coming of Dynamite. It's doing better and better and better and better. And Rampage has found its identity. Now, I'm going to be curious to look at those numbers sometime next week and how they've improved. And what does it mean to have Hook as a regular thing on that show? I saw, I think it was Lance Storm who had his shit take. Lance Storm's take. Was that they should move Hook immediately to Dynamite. As opposed to having him be one of the crown jewels of Rampage and help that show along. That's where Hook is. He's helping a show at AEW. It's one of the cornerstone things of that show. It's just an incredible thing. Speaking of an incredible thing, I got to put this up. Third story, FTR wrestled the Rock and Roll Express in front of 1,000 people. And for those who don't get that, that's an amazing number to draw. That's an amazing number to draw. And Edge was there. What's that about? Pretty great. But FTR got to live out their dream, wrestle the Rock and Roll Express. It looks really cool by all accounts. What can you say? It's awesome. We're going to end, as we always do, with a video clip, and the video clip is from that match. Steve, how? Because I'm Steven Platinum, bitch. In any case, it's wonderful that the dreams are coming true. The fun is living all over pro wrestling, and the dreams are coming true that have nothing necessarily to do with the WrestleMania moment. And that's a huge sea change in wrestling, and if people keep fighting me on it, you can fight all day. But it is what it is. In any case, this has been 1, 2, 3, the Platinum Pinfall. Go out and make your own dreams come true, bitch.